These are furnaces or fired heaters, and they have the letter abbreviation H. Furnaces heat up streams anywhere up to 400 through 1500 degrees centigrade by using flammable gases usually, but in some cases flammable oil, liquids, or solids can also be combusted. The flammable gas being burned is usually methane or propane, but it can also be a leftover stream that needs to be disposed. This is another example of a very expensive piece of equipment, and it's usually only used when streams need to be heated to extremely high temperatures. The hottest furnace I've ever seen was heating up an ethane stream to 1200 degrees centigrade to eventually make plastic. These high temperatures mean that the inside of furnaces are usually lined with large ceramic bricks, which is one of the best ways to keep the heat from escaping. Let's briefly look at how this piece of equipment works. Like compressors, this is actually a pretty accurate representation of the general shape of a furnace. Large furnaces are almost always very tall, about 5 to 10 stories, with a high vent stack, and there can be a few of them in a row running parallel. Also, lots of furnaces have vertically aligned tubes, which helps take advantage of a tall, upright design. The flammable gases enter here near the bottom and are burned with oxygen through burners at the bottom of the furnace. This heats up whatever process stream is sent through the tubes. The combusted gases leave the flue stack at the top of the furnace. The process stream enters the tubes and is heated by the surrounding hot gas and then leaves the furnace. The tubes in this bottom section receive the most radiant heat from the gas being burned, and so this zone is called the radiant section. This area above is a little bit shielded and absorbs less heat. It's called the convective section, and it's lower in temperature compared to the radiant section. There are a few common fuel sources used in furnaces, and they each have their own abbreviation. Some of these include natural gas, abbreviated as NG, and this is usually methane. Fuel gas, abbreviated FG, which can represent any gas being burned as fuel, including a byproduct stream. Liquefied petroleum gas, abbreviated LPG, which is usually propane or butane. Or fuel oil, abbreviated FO, which is any heating oil being burned. You'll usually see these abbreviations on the side or bottom of the furnace, signifying the fuel source being used. Lastly, this furnace symbol is what you would most likely see in ChemCAD, and this is the one you would see in Aspen. Let's next look at an equipment summary table for fired heaters. There's no fired heater in our ethylene oxide process, but I created this equipment summary table just as an example so we can see the information which needs to be shown if it were part of the process diagram. First, the type of heater must be shown. There are three main varieties of fired heaters: gas-fired heaters, liquid-fired heaters, and solid-fired heaters. The gases typically burned include methane, which is the main component of natural gas, propane, or unwanted byproduct gases from the process which need to be combusted. The liquids typically burned include flammable hydrocarbons, such as gasoline, diesel, or flammable oil. Sometimes these liquids, like the gases, can be unwanted byproduct streams which need to be disposed through combustion. The solids typically burned include coal, coke, anthracite, or other flammable fuel solids. Almost all of these fuel sources have the same adiabatic flame temperature. In other words, for a well-insulated system, the exiting gases are at the same temperature for almost all of these fuels. But the gases actually burn more easily and the heat can be transferred faster. So if a process stream needs to be heated to a hotter temperature, such as around 2000 degrees Fahrenheit, it's generally best to use a gas. Also, in large chemical processes such as refineries or commodity chemicals manufacturing, natural gas is the most common fuel choice because of its high burning temperature and because it combusts cleanly and easily. So this is why I chose a fired gas furnace burning natural gas. Next, the shell and tube side materials of construction should be specified. The shell of the furnace is the space where the flammable gas, liquid, or solid is being combusted. Depending on the temperature of this combustion, the materials chosen could be stainless steel or nickel-based alloys, which both withstand temperatures up to 1100 degrees centigrade, or ceramics, which can tolerate temperatures up to 3000 degrees centigrade. Ceramic bricks are the most common choice for the shell structure of most large furnaces, since it's cheaper than most high-temperature metals, so this is why I chose that material for this furnace. The tube side needs to withstand the temperature of the surrounding hot gases and be able to properly contain the process stream without leaking. The tube side material, just as with any material chosen for a heat exchanger, should be able to withstand the temperature of the combusting gas and the chemical reactivity of the process stream. I chose stainless steel for the tube side since it has good heat tolerance, remains relatively unreactive at high temperatures, and should not rupture under extreme temperature conditions. Next, the heat duty needs to be provided. If you're using ChemCat or Aspen, this is calculated for you, and this information can be found under the equipment specifications for the furnace. You can also calculate this by hand by determining the heat required to raise the temperature of your process stream from the inlet to the desired outlet temperature. This heat duty calculation is the same one you would perform for a heat exchanger. Next, the radiant and convective areas of the fired heater need to be specified. There are two sections to a fired heater, the radiant and the convective. You may choose to forego having a convective section, but I don't recommend this because it leads to a furnace design with low efficiency and wasted heat. To calculate the area of the radiant and convective sections, you can use a process simulator to more accurately estimate heat transfer coefficients depending on the fuel and process stream, or you can perform some hand calculations using design estimates. Some textbooks offer the heuristic that equal heat transfer should occur in both the radiant and convective sections. Also, another useful heuristic is that the rate of heat transfer per unit time per unit area in the radiant section can be assumed to be around 38 kilowatts per meter squared. And not surprisingly, in the convective section it's lower, 12.5 kilowatts per meter squared. So I took half of the heat duty and divided by these power per unit area values to calculate the area of the radiant and convective sections. And you can check my work here if you'd like to be sure I did this correctly. The last section in the table should include pertinent physical properties of the process fluid. This information can be taken directly from the stream table. These temperatures and pressures are important to include to help size piping and verify that proper materials of construction are being used. Notice that shell side pressure is not as important since most of the gases will be rising and exiting through the vent at the top of the furnace. Notice also that fluid density is not included because it varies quite a bit for the gas phase process stream, since the temperature increase can be substantial. Thanks for watching.